campus sport and some of the latest names to make their mark on the senior world stage. A popular initiative by the International University Sports Federation with free cardiac tests at the Universiades. And the French who got a hero's welcome home, plus two high achievers who made the very best of their university days. First, we pay our respects to the student athletes who excelled at the Universiade this summer and then went on to the Athletics World Championships in Beijing with considerable success. Of the 127 former Universiade athletes taking part in the Bird's Nest, 31 won medals. 10 gold, 8 silver, 13 bronze. The three-time Universiade champion, Pavel Fajdek from Poland, took the world title in the hammer throw. After gold at the Guangzhou Universiade in July, he defended his world crown just a few weeks later. Jessica Ennis-Hill won the bronze medal in the heptathlon at the Summer Universiade of 2005 in Izmir, the beginning of a magnificent career. The Olympic champion in 2012, this August, Jessica took her second world title in Beijing. Germany's Katharina Molitor became the world champion in the javelin. She'd finished sixth in the Universiade of 2007 and fourth in 2009, and her career has continued in an upward trajectory. In Beijing, it was her very last throw that gave her the victory. The 102-meter gold medalist at the Kazan Universiade was one of the surprises at the Beijing World Championships. In the 200 meters race, he chased the great Usain Bolt to take the bronze medal. Anaso Jobowana, age 23, from South Africa. One of the big surprises at the Guangzhou Universiade was the performance of Hugh Zhango. He won the silver medal in the triple jump, a big moment in terms of sporting achievement for Burkina Faso. I'm really proud of myself because, well, since, you know, I really didn't believe it. Then I did my first jump and I realized that it was possible and that I had the capacity to jump further. Anyway, the obstacles were really huge, even without good opponents. I thought it was going to be difficult because I didn't think I could produce that kind of performance there. I really didn't at the age of 22, but it came faster than expected. So I took my first jump and then prepared for the next one. The first medal for Burkina Faso in a great global competition. And Hugh achieved it with the longest triple jump of his life. In my country, I never really jumped 16 meters. At home, I jumped around, 15 meters 50? I'm not too motivated there because there isn't actually any real competition. But when I go abroad, I always produce my best. The reason is simple. His sporting ambitions are limited in his country by the lack of infrastructure, the lack of competition, and by the lack of equipment. At some point, if the equipment is not good, it necessarily limits performance. But in our country, we work within very small means. And a jumper like him, who has talent but lack of competition, well, it's difficult for him. Otherwise, he should be able to jump 17 meters. And he hasn't got a very good pair of jumping shoes either. Well, that clearly limits him. When you wear a shoe, they're used shoes that we buy, incidentally, and we paint them. And then we keep the shoe until it tears, and then we throw it away. Otherwise, it's always with us. But then, we just use it. They're not even my shoes, these. I borrow them in my country to be able to come to the competition. The triple jump is a very explosive discipline. It requires a highly crafted shoe to protect the foot and avoid injury. New shoes are difficult to obtain in Burkina Faso for a student whose sport is conditioned by his academic studies. I was lucky, you know, because after my master's degree, I got a scholarship that allowed me to go to a school of engineering, one of the best schools of its kind in Ouagadougou. But looking at the academic side, I'm pretty happy because every year I finish top or second in my class. And that's also why my parents support me. I wouldn't say they give me financial support, but they help me anyway. When I have to train by myself, whether I need gasoline for my motorcycle and so on, they help me in small ways be able to go to the stadium. Despite his limited resources, Hugh Zango was able to take maximum advantage of the Guangzhou Universiad to lift his spirits, please his fans, and more. I think it actually made me dream. And then my ambitions, you know, are beginning to be realized too. I think I can go further now, and I will go further. Hugh Zango from Burkina Faso, top of the class at the Universiad of Guangzhou. Great legacy from the Kazan Universiad, with two venues used at the recent FINA World Championships. And again, former Universiad competitors performed well at the World Championships. This was Jenny Johansson's race. At the Belgrade University Games in 2009, she finished fifth in the 50 meters breaststroke. In Kazan, she became world champion. Hungary's Laszlo Shay has shone at the University Games and on the world stage. He got three gold medals at the 2011 Shenzhen Universiad, and this summer, at the FINA World Championships, he added one gold in the 50 meters butterfly and another silver and bronze medal too. The Hungarian swimmer confirming that a Universiad can be an excellent stepping stone up to the very top. Coming up on campus, FISU's medical initiative and word from one of sport's renowned leaders. Plus, the French who got a hero's welcome home and two high achievers who made the very best of their university days.
The International University Sports Federation brings together millions of students worldwide around the same values, excellence in mind and body. Thousands of students, hundreds of universities participate in FISU events, the rendezvous for the best student athletes. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Since Kazan in 2013, FISU's medical commission has been on hand to carry out heart monitoring on site for all its athletes at a Universiad on a voluntary basis. But how does it work? Well, at Guangzhou, in the village clinic, athletes were able to call on Dr. Kyle Hornsby for a free test.
So you have a tendency. So this is a check of your heart center. We have four different stations. One of them is the check-in station, in which they'll get a questionnaire and they fill out their name. We fill out some of their basic information, give them an ID number. They'll answer yes or no to symptoms that they may be having, and also to whether or not they have any family history of cardiovascular disease.
I think they're trying to get a more broader spectrum of all the athletes' hearts. So when they when somebody does come in with a problem, they can diagnose that quicker and get better results.
In Guangzhou, over 2,000 athletes passed the test.
We hope to prevent sudden death in athletes. We think sudden death is not a common problem, and thank goodness it's not, but it's still the most common cause of death in a university athlete. We believe with an extensive evaluation, you will be able to detect those athletes that might have sudden death and to be able to protect them.
This is station number two, and we get height and wingspan, and then they also do a weight with a body fat mass machine. It's basically called InBody. That gives them a lot of information on BMI, basal metabolic rate, and we do check everyone's blood pressure and pulse.
Then the real cardiac tests begin.
So after station number two comes station number three. So we're in the EKG station. We've got the 12 leads set up for a resting EKG. This is looking at the electrical conduction of the heart and looking for any abnormal heart rhythms or other findings that we would find abnormal for an athlete. We're about to run the EKG.
But how do athletes feel about the test?
I think it's only normal for you to be a little hesitant when walking in here. These athletes have trained many, many years in most instances to compete in games like this. So it could be a little bit of an anxious experience coming in and going through this testing, knowing that there is a very small potential for finding a significant abnormality. The fourth station, it's the echocardiogram. It's an ultrasound of the heart. We're looking at heart function, valvular abnormalities, those sorts of things that might be normal for an athlete, but maybe abnormal for a normal person. So we'll look at those ultrasound images to look into the heart, look at chamber sizes, function of the chambers, valve function, et cetera, to make sure that his heart is okay to compete.
For many athletes from developing countries, the program is an opportunity to have access to the only cardiac test of their lives.
We know that a weightlifter has clearly different characteristics to their heart than, let's say, a 1,500 meter champion or a marathon. We know the heart is different. And we're also looking at that also, the difference in the athlete's heart based on not just where they're from, but also their sport.
The results are usable in care centers all over the world.
After the test, they gave you all the results on a memory stick. I think you can plug into your computer, and it would tell you, it would give you all the results and all of your information.
Right. He's going to give you a card with all this information on. Oh, you already got it. Okay. All right.
And this unique program is going to be continued in the next Universiad. The International Tennis Federation, with its Grand Slam tournaments, the Davis Cup and the Fed Cup, lights up the international sporting calendar. For 16 years until just a few days ago, the head of the ITF was Francesco Riccibitti, a man who has always maintained close links with the university world and FISU. There are many reasons for these links. The first one is personal. I was a college player. I played at the Universiad at least once. The second reason is an ideal. I think now professional sport is pushed to the extreme in every way. Physically, and with the sort of engineering of boys and girls who don't yet understand that the work they've done is conditioned by their family, their coach, and perhaps it can be too much. I think that sport is good if you have other things that bring balance, and studies bring balance. For this former tennis player, studies are indispensable. It was as a result of all his studies that Francesco was able to progress and reach the highest position in the administration of his sport. When I was elected, I thought my experience as a good tennis player and a good sportsman would be the most important aspect. But I have to accept that I was wrong. The most important aspect was my experience of business that comes from education. Tennis is one of the world's major sports, but only a few hundred men and women can make a really good living from playing the game. We have not only the responsibility of boys who happen to be Nadal or Djokovic or Federer. Our responsibility is for the 99%, the rest of the players that we have to deal with. If these are balanced people, they're very useful to our sport. And I don't mean just in our world of sport. We need people who are balanced, who use their sporting experience as a positive. University offers many advantages to tennis. First, the Universiad, the world's biggest international tennis tournament for student athletes. But it also opens up new horizons outside the usual tournaments on the circuit, like Guangzhou, for example. Here you have competitors who come from Uganda, Uzbekistan, from different parts of the world. They come here to play, and from my point of view, it's a very, very good thing. Obviously, there are different levels of playing, but it's also the spirit of the Universiad. And the possibility of sharing passions with other students. And I believe the Olympic Games and the Universiads are a reminder reminder that tennis is one sport amongst many, and that opens the mind to these young people. And that is quite a bonus. Francesco Ricciabitti is leaving the ITF to take over as the head of Sport Accord, the Association of International Sports Federations, where he'll continue to keep an eye on tennis and the Universiades. FISO officials have to be mindful about things. They must look at the calendar. The tennis calendar is a key to whether you can have the best athletes taking part or not. They have to facilitate participation if possible, and they have to promote university sports in all the various countries. I think these are the three keys. Still to come, one successful team at the World University Games hailed as heroes back home. And two high achievers who made the very best of their university days in sport and study, Stephen Caron and Clément Lafaire.
When education meets sport and culture, what best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
When they got back home, the French Universiade team from Guangzhou were honored at the State Department for Higher Education and Research. The 228 student athletes won 30 medals in South Korea, and they're regarded as role models.
We're in an era where we're lacking heroes, really, and thus to have heroes like this who are capable of giving a taste of the work and the effort is great.
With 13 golds, 9 silver, and 8 bronze, France finished 6th in the medal table behind South Korea, Russia, China, Japan, and the USA. Reason enough to celebrate. The president of the French University Sports Federation had this to say. We had a quality young team, a structuring of the federation that's among the 4 best in the world, maybe the best, and then also an excellent collaboration with the civil federations. And all these factors create a dynamic. Everybody's involved, and everybody wins together.
On crée une dynamique, tout le monde s'y met, et on emporte tout.
But for the Universiade champion, Frédéric Josinet, another factor also explains their success. I believe what also made the French team go a little further, a little faster, go a little higher, was the team spirit, which was bred in that university team. Hawa Kamara won the first French gold medal in judo in the 78 kilogram category. The science and education student remembers her emotions after her victory, her best result in her career so far. When I knew that I'd won, it was such a relief. I was so happy with what I'd achieved. It was the first day of the competition. Everybody was so glad. The joy was really shared by the team and the spectators. I just wanted to jump up and celebrate. Fencing athletes were the most successful with 11 medals, individually, men and women, in foil, épée and sabre. The French fencers took 1/3 of the medals up for grabs. The previous record was 8 in Daegu in 2003.
Make your desires reality.
I was proud to represent the team in Guangzhou. And it wasn't just about the victory, but the fact of representing my sport, my discipline, in an event like this. For sure, it was an immense pleasure. London has been the financial hub of the United Kingdom and a major trade and business center since the Middle Ages. Much of London's finance industry is located in the square mile, or the city. More than 390,000 people are employed there. One of them is the former world-class swimmer, Stephen Caron.
I work in the financial world. I'm responsible for a fund of private money, which invests in companies. And you know, I think that sport taught me to manage teams, to give feedback, and to understand what motivates individuals. So it's a toolbox, if you like. His passion for business and finance started early. At the age of 20, I began to invest in the stock exchange when I was in training sessions with the French team. There was a coach who was also interested in finance, and I often spoke with him. I always wanted to have a career, and I always wanted to work in the city. Between 1985 and 1992, the Frenchman was one of the best swimmers in freestyle. At that time, support from the universities was rare. Stéphane Carrand didn't have it easy, because he was studying at the same time. But for him, there was no question of neglecting his sport or his university work. There are different periods in the season, in the year, if you like, where we emphasize one discipline more than the other. In the exam period, I put the brakes on training. But on the other hand, in preparation for big championships, I trained much more. I knew all this was going to end in extraordinary things. I'd always trusted in myself, and I never had problems in making sacrifices. Stéphane was the 1985 European champion and a bronze medalist at the Olympic Games in 1988 in the 100 meters freestyle. He also competed in the Universiade of 1991 in Sheffield, unbeatable in the 50, 100 and 200 meters freestyle. As an academic, it seemed to me completely normal to take part in a large-scale international event. Secondly, I think the World Student Games are like a mini Olympics, if you like. The sports level was excellent. For me, it was a springboard for my career afterwards. It allowed me to get back on track for the Olympic Games. It was a really important stage in my career.
C'était un peu un tremplin pour la suite. C'est ce qui m'a permis de me remettre en selle pour les Jeux Olympiques. Donc c'était vraiment une étape importante dans ma carrière.
In 1992, Carrand left university and won the Olympic bronze in the 100 meters freestyle in Barcelona. It was then that he switched to the business world. I was lucky to be able to manage at the same time a sporting career at a very good level and a university career at a very good level, which means that today I'm completely satisfied with my personal and professional life. So now he wants to inspire, to be a role model for others. I think it's important to have role models in sport and also at work. So if I can give something back and tempt young people to practice high-level sport and to succeed in their professional life, then somewhere I'll have succeeded in something. Driven on by his passion for high-level sport and finance, today Stéphane Carrand is in a good place. A few kilometers away from the city, in Knightsbridge, another French swimmer followed in the wake of Stéphane Carrand, the Olympic champion in the 4x100 meters relay at London 2012, Clément Lefebvre. 3 years later, he's in front of a screen scrutinizing mysterious curves. I do analysis on petrol. It means that we study the supply and the demand in the oil market. We take speculative positions in the increase or in the reduction of the price of oil. Finance is a very competitive environment. It reminds me just a little bit of swimming at a high level, where it's necessary to know how to be at your best, how to seize the objectives, and how to work hard to obtain what you want. It's just a different kind of stress, slightly different feelings. But it's true, it remains a job that's fascinating, that I needed after a sporting career, to remain motivated, to have something that fascinates and enthuses me in my daily life. I'd like to continue to progress and one day manage my own portfolio myself, just to be successful. Lefebvre, who's a native of Nice, never thought that London would one day play an important role in his life. But after his Olympic title, he took a master's degree in finance and moved into the business capital.
Je pense avoir une reconversion.
I think I made a successful conversion. I prefer to stop swimming in 2012 after that Olympic title with the 4x100 meters relay because I think I'd achieved what I wanted.
Parce que je pensais avoir accompli ce que je voulais faire et que
I always wanted to have a second career after that, and that is what I'm doing now. After the 2008 Olympic Games, Lefebvre was recruited by a Californian university where he studied economics and finance. A beneficial experience for a man who would also win a relay gold at the 2010 European Championships. I decided very quickly to leave for the USA, where I was able to maintain a level of more or less professional training and obtain a master's in finance. At the same time, I wanted to see the sport from the American side. We often say that Americans have another culture of sport, another vision of sport, and it's true. I discovered that over there, and I think it helped me to mature enormously. It was in 2011 in Shenzhen that Clément Lefebvre took part in the World University Games. He was the flag bearer for France, and then he won two medals, bronze in the 4x100 meters relay and silver in the 200 meters freestyle, where his quick time qualified him for the London Olympics. Shenzhen was the launch pad for his Olympic gold medal. To achieve what he has, Lefebvre had to overcome difficult moments, juggling his studies and his sports career. But his message for student athletes is clear. You shouldn't forget that life is long and that the sporting part, although it's intense and magnificent, is short-lived. And there's a second life afterwards. And you shouldn't neglect that. And at difficult times, you have to remain concentrated to pursue your goals and to do the best that you can.
Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
When education meets sport and culture, what best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.